Hello and welcome to New Frontiers on CCTV International. I'm Ji Xiaojun in Beijing. In our program today, we're taking you to Zhousun, a small village in Shandong province. Zhousun has several claims to fame. For one thing, it's the place where a Tang Dynasty mannequin site was discovered. Manichaeism, which was founded in the 3rd century by the Persian prophet Mani, spread to China along the Silk Road in the 6th century at the time of the Tang Dynasty. Better known in China as Mo Ni Jiao, it was very quickly banned. As a result, buildings and inscriptions associated with Manichaeism are extremely rare. So, the discovery of the mannequin site at Zhousun, a long way from the Silk Road, sparked considerable interest. Among the scholars who came to investigate was Dr. Rolf Kaus from the University of Munich in Germany.
On January 8, 1998, Dr. Rolf Kaus, a sinologist from the University of Munich in Germany, flew to Beijing. From there, he took the train south to the city of Sibo in Shandong province. He wanted to find a man he knew to be living in the Jiaochan district of Sibo. This man, he hoped, would guide him to a mysterious religious site. Dr. Kaus's journey to Jiaochan had been inspired by an article he'd read in a Chinese academic journal. The journal was History and Annals, and he'd come across a copy at the Chinese Research Center of Overseas Communications History in Chuanzhou, Fujian Province. Dr. Kaus was fascinated by the article, which was about the discovery of a Tang Dynasty Manichaean site at Jiaochan. As an expert on China-Persian relations, Dr. Kaus had several times visited Chuanzhou, which was famous as the starting point of the Silk Road on the sea. He was particularly interested in Chuanzhou's Chao'an Temple, which was a center of Manichaean worship. Founded in the 3rd century by the Persian prophet Mani, Manichaeism spread to China in the 6th century via the Silk Road. In China, it evolved into Mingzhao, or the Ming religion. Dr. Kaus knew that the influence of Manichaeism in China was focused along the Silk Road, since this was the route by which it was first introduced into the country. However, the religion was banned in the mid-Tang Dynasty soon after its arrival. Consequently, buildings and inscriptions associated with Manichaeism in China are now extremely rare. The article he'd read, detailing the discovery of a Manichaean site in Jiaochun, intrigued Dr. Kaus. Yet, he was, at the same time, quite skeptical. Jiaochun was a small town in Shandong, far away from the ancient Silk Road. Moreover, there had been no previous reports about Manichaean sites in the region. He also found it hard to accept that the temple was supposed to have been constructed around the time that Manichaeism first reached China. Jiaochun is a county-level administrative district under the city of Sibo in Shandong province. Time of the Shang Dynasty, more than 3,000 years ago, it was at the heart of a kingdom called Wuling. In the spring and autumn and Warring States period, over 2,000 years ago, it was called Wulingyi. By that time, it was a major population center under the state of Qi, lying just 50 kilometers away from Linxi, the Qi capital. During the Han and Tang dynasties in the first millennium AD, it developed into a center of commerce. In Zhaochun, Dr. Kaus visited the site of the Mingzhou Temple, which dated from the Tang dynasty. He also saw what Guo Jisheng told him was a Manichaean stone statue. The Mingzhou Temple is one of the oldest buildings in Zhaochun. The Suyi Palace tablets in Zhaochun, written during the reign of the Qing Emperor Kangxi in the late 17th and early 18th century, record that the temple was first built in the Tang Dynasty and renovated in the Yuan Dynasty. The Yuan Dynasty was a period of relative religious tolerance. In certain places, Manichaeism was practiced openly, such as at the Chao'an Temple in Chuangzhou. This would also explain why the Mingzhou Temple was renovated at that time. The stone statue, which some believe to depict the Manichaean deity, is now housed at the Zhaochun District Administration Office of Cultural Relics. On the back is inscribed, "Made on the first day of the mid-spring in the 10th year of the reign of Zhengguan of the Tang Dynasty." The front depicts the main deity and four servant gods at the top. The lower part is carved with five strange images.
对于这一尊造像，因为它上面没有明确的摩尼教的字样，所以有人也提出了不同的意见，认为它是一个佛教的造像。说为此呢，我阅读了我国著名的摩尼教研究专家林武书先生的许多著作，也请教了有关的专家。认为这个佛造像的像板部，它有五个奇怪的形象，这五个形象呢与摩尼教里边的无名字。
In a thesis discussing the debate on the images in the statue, Dr. Kaus wrote, "Guo Jisheng has found two Manichaean sites in Shandong. One is an extraordinary statue erected in the 10th year of the Zhengguan period of the Tang Dynasty, which is apparently related to Manichaeism. The other is a stone tablet produced in the 41st year of the reign of Kangxi in the Qing Dynasty, which records that the Mingzhou Temple was built under Tang and renovated under Yuan. In other words, it seemed that Manichaeism could well have reached Zhaochun in the early Tang Dynasty." During his stay in Zhaochun, Dr. Kaus also sampled some of the unique local food, including Zhaochun sesame seed cake.
周村烧饼的前身叫糊饼，糊饼是一种什么样的食品呢？它是古代阿拉伯地区的一种商旅食品，古代沿着丝绸之路进入我们中国。这个糊饼在我们中国流传了2000多年，基本上没什么变化。 但是到了这个1899年的时候，在周村烧饼作坊里有一个叫郭海廷的小伙子，这个人挺爱动脑筋。他呢突发奇想，在制作的时候就把手中这个面筋揉一遍的揉得非常的薄，然后沾上芝麻，切到这个炉顶上进行烘烤，就制作出了我们今天所看到的周村烧饼。
Dr. Kaus was surprised by just how early Manichaeism had evidently reached Zhaochun from the ancient Persian Empire. He wondered if there might be some previously undiscovered connection between Shandong and the ancient Silk Road.
It's well known that the Silk Road was an international trade route linking ancient China to the Western world. In 138 BC, Emperor Wu Di of the Han Dynasty sent his envoy Zhang Qian to explore the West. Zhang Qian, taking with him vast quantities of Chinese silk, eventually reached the eastern shore of the Mediterranean Sea and even Rome, having traveled via the Gansu Corridor, the Tian Shan Mountains, and Central and Western Asia. Thus, a key communication route was opened up between the East and the West, which would later be called the Silk Road by German geographer Ferdinand von Richthofen. For centuries, the city of Xi'an had been considered the starting place of the Silk Road. Chang'an, as it was called at the time, was the capital of the Han and Tang dynasties, and it was from where Zhang Quan set out for the West. Xi'an, however, was not a major producer of silkworms and silk. It merely served as a center for their distribution.
这个很少有人知道啊，在汉唐时期的这个长安周围啊，也就是我们所说的关中地区，当时这个丝绸的产量和质量在全国来说都是非常低的，以至于这个关中地区啊，向朝廷交纳的这个赋贡中，丝麻的数量啊，那是少得可怜。所以当时皇帝啊，就曾经有专门的下令，叫做“官服寡蚕，招纳米粟”，也就是说， 不得不呢粮食来代替。那至于这个关中向西南，也就是现在的这个河西啊、新疆这一带啊，在两汉时期就基本上没有桑蚕业。那么问题是，这个丝绸之路的丝绸是从哪来的呢？
In September 1990, Openings Magazine, run by the Publicity Department of the Shandong People's Government, organized a seminar to discuss origin of the Silk Road. The experts at the meeting agreed that Shandong was an important starting point of the ancient trade route. The following year, the magazine published a series of 5 articles in 3 consecutive editions, which backed up the claim with more detailed historical research. One of the authors was Qi Tao, a young lecturer in history at Shandong University. In his book, Exploring the Source of the Silk Road, which was published in 1992, Qi Tao systematically explained why Shandong must have been the main source of silk production for the ancient Silk Road.
它这个在古代啊，山东是风调雨顺，气候温和，湿润，很适合啊这桑麻生产。那么山东桑麻生产的发达啊，开始于七国。 就是春秋战国七国，七国的开国者呢，就是姜太公。姜太公到七国上任之后啊，实际上推行了三大政策。第一大政策，他就是兴于盐之利；第二大政策呢，就是劝女工之业。这个女工之业就是桑麻纺织，这说的女工之业。第三大政策呢是通商。所以有了他这三个政策， 对山东的这个蚕桑丝织业的发展起了巨大的推动作用。In
studying China's ancient silk industry, Qi Tao analyzed both archaeological finds and historical records. Since 1949, archaeologists in Shandong have made several important discoveries of exquisite silk fabrics dating back to the spring and autumn and the Warring States periods. But even more important to understanding the development of the silk industry in ancient China in a thorough and comprehensive way is the historical records passed down to us over the centuries. Records of the Grand Historian, written by the Western Han historian Sima Qian, and the Book of Han by Bang Gu of the Eastern Han Dynasty, are widely recognized as the most authoritative records of their respective historical periods. Both works deal in detail with the economic situation at the time. Records of the Grand Historian, in recording regional products, states, An Yi produces dates, chestnuts are products of Yan and Qin, Shuhan and Jiangling yield oranges. Wormwood is from south of the Changshan Mountain in Huaibei and Heiji. Sumacs are produced of chun and xia. Qi and lu are rich in silk and hemp, and bamboo is abundant in Wechuan.
司马迁在《或者列传》里面呢讲的这个意思啊，就是安邑啊，这个千树凿，安邑呢就是现在的山西省的南部。雁禽千树栗，栗子的栗，雁禽呢，雁当然就是河北了，禽就是相当于现在的陕西一带，这是大片的种植栗子。他还讲的这个蜀汉江陵千树菊，蜀汉江陵相当于现在的四川和重庆。讲山东的时候呢，就齐鲁千亩桑麻。那么这是讲全国各个地方的经济区域的划分，山东的特色就是千亩桑麻，也就是说出现了大规模的连片的桑麻的这种规模经济，也就是桑麻的最大的生产地。
In his book The Book of Han, Eastern Han historian Ban Gu wrote,Taigong, the Grand Duke, knew that the state of Qi was not a suitable area for traditional farming and that the population was small. So he encouraged silk weaving, as well as fishing and salt industries. Such was the success of this that its silk products were soon found across the whole country.
Ban Gu 讲这个意思啊。和司马迁讲的那个齐鲁千亩桑麻，它是一脉相承的，还是讲齐国这个地方的桑枝蚕桑纺织业是怎么发达。你比如说他就用了几个形容词，这几个形容词呢在后代常用，一个是冠带衣履天下。所谓冠带衣履天下呢，冠当然头上戴的帽子，带呢就是身上织的那个扎的那个带子，衣履，衣就是衣服了，履就是鞋了。所以冠带衣履天下呢，就是说齐鲁这个地方啊出产的这个丝织品呢已经覆盖到了全国各地，各地的人都来用这个齐地出产的丝织品，这是冠带衣履天下。
Writing in his book Exploring the Source of the Silk Road, Qi Tao, by referring to the records of the Grand Historian and the Book of Han, produced a series of diagrams to describe the regional economyThe distribution of products in the Han Dynasty and categories of goods sent to the imperial court as tax. These diagrams show that Shandong at the time of the Han Dynasty was indisputably the center of the silk textile industry in China. However, interestingly, while both the records of the Grand Historian and the Book of Han single out Shandong alone as the center of silk production, from the Tang Dynasty onwards, historians seemed less confident about making that same assertion.
The period following the Eastern Han Dynasty from about 220 AD saw the center of China's economic activity shift southwards.By the early years of the Tang Dynasty in the 7th century, the region south of the Yangtze had caught up with the north in economic terms. At the forefront of this economic development was the silk industry.
A diagram drawn by Qi Tao, based on the Tang Liu Dian, the official annals of the Tang Dynasty, shows that the silk industry was thriving in five places, namely Shandong,Hunan, Hebei, Sichuan, and Jiangyan, or the South Yangtze region. But the silk products of Shandong were still the national leader in terms of quality and volume, followed by Hunan, Hebei, Sichuan, and Jiangyan. Ban Gu, who we see here, in the chapter called The Biography of Gong Yu, from his Book of Han,records that in olden times the Sangfuguan office was rather small. Now it employs thousands of people with an astounding expenditure each year. The famous Tang Dynasty scholar Yan Shigu explained that Sangfuguan is mainly responsible for making clothes for the emperor, and its office is in Qi. In fact, Sanfu Guan was the official textile administration under the Han central government.
So, Sanfu Guan在汉代是专门设在齐国这个地方，齐地。本身它实际上能说明这么三个问题。第一个问题呢，就是齐国这个地方的丝织品生产水平是全国最高的。所以第二个问题呢，也就是说明它对官府的丝绸供应起着非常重要的作用。第三个问题呢，那么既然三副官设在齐地，又表明齐地有当时最高的生产工艺和最高的生产水平，我们再结合前面已经讲到的生产规模来讲呢，齐地也是全国遥遥领先，加到一起啊，实际上就说明了齐地是当时中国最大的丝绸的供货地和外销地。
For 1,000 years, from the Qin Dynasty to the Han and Tang dynasties, Qi was the national center for the production and trading of silk. Jiaochun, situated in the heart of Qi, must also have been heavily involved in the silk industry.But what was Jiaochun like historically? And what role did it play in the production of silk and the silk trade throughout China? In the 1970s, Hao Runji visited Jiaochun to conduct research there.Hao, a renowned historical geographer, an academician with the Chinese Academy of Sciences, and a professor at Peking University, recorded his findings in his book, The Theory and Application of Historical Geography. In his book, Hao wrote, Jiaochun, formerly known as Wuling, embraces a profound history.A mountain shaped like a mythical three-legged bird was once worshipped locally as a bird totem. The area developed into an important city during the Shang and Zhao dynasties. The site of the ancient city of Wuling has been found. In 1982,Several silk spinning wheels dating from the New Stone Age were unearthed beside the old city walls. The discovery suggested that Jiaochun might well have been the earliest mulberry planting and silk textile producing region in the country. A local legend goes, in ancient times, a phoenix flew to Wuling. In its beak, it carried a silkworm cocoon.In Wuling, it taught the locals to weave silk for clothing. During the period of the Republic of China, in the first half of the 20th century, further evidence was found of Jiaochun's importance in China's silk industry. In 1934, the Trade Ministry of the Republic of China sent an official to Jiaochun to investigate silk production there historically.The official was Zhao Janyuan, and with some local assistance, he conducted a highly detailed study of Jiaochun's silk industry. After returning to Nanjing, Zhao Janyuan wrote a long report based on his research there. Called An Investigation of the Silk and Hemp Industry of Jiaochun, it was published in the magazine Economic Journal.In September that year. The report, citing numerous very reliable sources, traced the historical development of the silk trade in Jiaochun.
Since the Warring States period, Jiaochun has been the center of silk production in Shandong. Geographically, Jiaochun enjoys a unique location, lying in a place where plains and mountains meet.Moreover, to the east lies the Bohai Sea, and on its western side runs a canal. These advantages had a major influence on making Jiaochun a key distribution center, principally of silk. As the center of the trade in high-quality silk products, Zhoucun no doubt attracted silk merchants from as far away as the western regions and Arabia. This would explain the presence of Manichaeism and of the Hubing cakes. Thank you for being with us on New Frontiers, and we'll bring you more stories about Zhoucun in our next program. I'm Ji Xiaojun from CCTV International. Bye-bye.